Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, SLCTV will feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair, because the lecture hall is about to begin.
Hi guys, well thank you for having me here tonight. I am Paul Gray, I work for Audubon Florida, I'm a staff scientist. I originally came here for graduate school at the University of Florida and never got out. So what I'll talk tonight about is, I'll talk a lot about the Okeechobee and Kissimmee Valley. That's where I live. I live over near the town of Sebring, and talk about what they're like, and I'll get into some of the birds and some of the natural history, but then also the changes that we've done. You know, people have moved in, we've drained and built farms and cities, and it's caused a lot of impacts. And you guys know about those mostly through the big Okeechobee dumps down to the St. Lucie estuary. I'll talk some about those. And then I'll talk about what we're trying to do to try to fix some of these problems and take the good things that come with human development and get rid of the bad things that we've done. So, what's this? Snail kite. Yeah, that's one of the focal birds for us. And they're only here in Florida. They don't go anywhere north. They are in Central America, but it's one of those unique Everglades birds. Okay, so you guys already know this. We're the Audubon Society, and we're named after John James Audubon, the bird artist from the 1830s. And these caracaras, when he drew these, guess where he shot them? St. Augustine. They're not that far north anymore. Their range is really reduced. But he shot them up along the St. John's River. Okay, and this is a picture of me in 1942. my name is Marvin Chandler. I'm the first Audubon warden on Lake Okeechobee. Notice Marvin's got two belt buckles. One's a badge. And when we hired him in 1936. That was back when we had laws on the books, but no one would enforce them. And so Audubon started hiring people, and the state and feds would deputize them, and they'd go around and enforce game laws. And so he was actually a game warden on Lake Okeechobee. And what's he holding? A water moccasin. And see how fat it is? He was out on Okeechobee with the Crookshanks, and they were filming a glossy ibis rookery. At that time, about 95% of all the glossy ibises known to be nesting in North America were nesting on King's Bar in Lake Okeechobee. They were all there. There were only about 1,500. And they were out photographing, and when they came back on the trail, they couldn't get around the snake, so they ended up killing it. Notice how fat it is? So they opened it up, and in its stomach it had three tricolored heron eggs, a glossy ibis egg, another egg that they couldn't identify, it was digested. It had a baby American egret and an adult glossy ibis in it. So if you find any water moccasins, they're very fun to play with. And this is the glossy ibis. And back then there were maybe only 1,500 in Florida, we think, and now they're actually pretty abundant. They're all over the place. So that's one of those success stories where they were protecting that rookery, and these guys are pretty common in Florida now. Okay, so what we're going to talk about is the Kissimmee Valley. And here's the Kissimmee chain of lakes, and they flow down to Lake Okeechobee. Here's Lake Istipoga. I actually live right there. That's where I'm from. And in the good old days, all this water up here went into Okeechobee, and almost all of it went into the Everglades. None of it came over here. None of it. The Atlantic Ridge stopped it, and some of it actually went down the Coosahatchee. But this is the good old days before all the people moved in and changed everything. So I'm going to be talking about this region up here. And notice that it's about 100 miles from Orlando, which the Orlando International Airport's the headwaters of the Everglades. And it's about 100 miles to Lake Okeechobee. It's also 100 miles to Florida Bay. So this area is just about the same size as the Everglades proper. And if you fly in the air, this is above the Kissimmee Prairie Preserve. And it's just a big, flat area. It's really, really flat, just like the Everglades. And this is an area that, and right now this is pretty dry, but in the summertime all this gray area will fill up, and it'll be wetlands and sloughs, and this will be all palmettos. During the peak of the wet season, this is all flooded. And there's stories of soldiers riding on horses back in the 1800s in January and never getting out of the water all day. This used to be an extraordinarily wet watershed. And so a drop of water in a pristine system that lands out here may stay here for a month. Whoops. Back up. A drop of water that lands a drop of water that lands out here may stay out here for a month, assuming it would stay together, and then it would get in the slough and take a couple months to go down to the Kissimmee River, and then it'd take a while to get down to Lake Okeechobee. So this watershed in the summer, we know about the wet season, it'd fill up with water and then very slowly drain down. That's a natural condition, and people know that the Everglades does that, but the whole Kissimmee Valley used to do that too. And this is the dry prairie. Have any of you guys been out to the Kissimmee Prairie? It's an extraordinary place. Can you see the oak tree in this picture? See the oak tree right here? This is one oak tree. They're runner oaks. And this ecosystem burns every couple years. We think there's about 25 lightning strikes per square mile per year out here. And so this place used to catch fire all the time. And so trees don't really grow, but this oak tree grows under the ground. Instead of sending up a trunk and spreading out, the trunk's under the ground, it spreads out under the ground and comes up. And they call it runner oak because if you were to pull on any one of these little stems, and they have oak leaves and they have acorns, if you were to pull on any stem, it's hooked up to the one next to it, next to it, next to it. And so that's how trees can live out in an extremely fire. It's an incredible place. And this is part of the reason why I am here and why Marvin Chandler was there. There's five species of endemic prairie birds. So what we'll go through them. What's this?
Sandhill.
The Florida sandhill crane. What are these? Florida mottled ducks, burrowing owls, the Florida grasshopper sparrow. This little guy is one of the most endangered birds in the United States, unfortunately. I spent a lot of time working on them. I'm not going to talk about them a whole lot, but we think there's less than 100 pairs left. And we're doing a lot of work, and they've just brought some into captivity to try to start a captive breeding flock. So there's a lot of work. The good news is there's a lot of work going on for them, but the bad news is they're having a rough time. Okay, and it's not all prairie. There's also flatwoods up there. You guys have seen all this type of habitat. And there's wonderful lakes. Okeechobee is the biggest lake in the state. The third largest is Lake Kissimmee. The fifth largest is Lake Istipogo. Those are all in the Okeechobee watershed. And here's the Kissimmee River. And this wasn't taken 50 years ago. This was taken only about 5 years ago. So they're doing the Kissimmee River restoration. I'll talk more about it later. But so this is flowing toward Lake Okeechobee. So it's a land of flatlands, prairies, flatwoods, marshes. It's a wonderful place. What's that? Lake Okeechobee. How wide is Okeechobee? It's 30 to 35 miles, depending on which direction you're going. And if you get out there in a boat in the middle, you can't see shore from any direction. I mean, here we're up in an airplane, and you can barely see the shore. And how deep will it be when you're right in the middle of the lake? 15 feet. Yeah, the bottom of Okeechobee is right about sea level. And so when Okeechobee is at 15 feet, that's the level, that's only 15 feet deep. So it's really, really shallow. This is along the Kissimmee River. One of the big fisheries in Okeechobee are crappie. And we catch, when the lake's working right, about 1 million crappie a year out of Okeechobee. It's more than the entire southeastern United States, probably. So it's really a great lake for tourism and things like that. And it's so big that it influences weather. These are rainfall things. This is the highest rainfall, next highest, next highest, next highest. Notice that on this day, the wind's blowing north, and notice the lowest rainfall is right at the lake, and there's a rain shadow behind it. And it's going to rain here and here, but there's no rain. And notice here, there's the lake's going to be dry, and everything's going to be wet around it. Why is that? These are summertime photos. Well, think about when in the summer, when the sun comes up, it starts heating the land and you get thunderstorms building up, they don't build up above the water because it's circulating. So the water doesn't heat and you get a buildup of ring of clouds around the lake. And actually when you're out boating in the summer, you'll see clouds all around the lake and you'll look out across the lake and there won't even be clouds. So that's how big this lake is. It influences the weather around it. And people think the middle of it's kind of a barrens. It's actually not. We found out when we flew in airplanes, there's hundreds of thousands of scop that'll be out there, way out in the middle where nobody can really get to. There's a commercial fishery out there for catfish. They drag mile-long or 1,000-yard purse seines, and they pull them in a circle, and they catch catfish and bluegill. And no one really knows what's going on because they're required to be a mile out so they don't have conflicts with commercial fish or sport fishermen. But anyway, so it's a huge lake, and it's got all this productivity in the middle of it. And it's got about 150,000 acres of marshes, about what would that be? About 200 square miles of marshes. About one third of the lake is wetlands. And this is during a drought. You can see the water is very low, but it's just full of all kinds of life. And this is a photo back at Moonshine Bay, and this is very much an Everglades type scene. If you look, if you can see under the water, there's periphyton under there. These are white water lilies. This is a sawgrass. And so Okeechobee is very much an Everglades type habitat. When it's working right, it's a very low nutrient, wonderful place. Okay, what's this? And what's the great blue got? There you go, a siren. See the leg? Yes, there's actually a siren in this room. If you want to look at this aquarium, there's a great big aquatic salamander, and it's actually a salamander, it's not a snake, and it's got a leg, and they have the frilly gills, and they live in the water. And there's actually, I think, three kinds of sirens in Florida. And you don't see them very often, but these guys find them and eat them. And it's just one of those weird things that Florida has things that other parts of the country just don't have. This is a stink pot turtle. This little guy is a pet for one of the guys that works for FWC. He's had it since he was a kid. Tucker's 25 years old. Actually, he's 26 now. And these guys live 50 years. And it's a stink pot turtle. And obviously, they don't get very big. He's related to this guy in this aquarium. But anyway, yeah, so people frequently see these little turtles. They don't think much of them. These can be very significant organisms. And well, it's a stink pot, which is very close to a musk turtle, and you got to look at the belly. But yeah, they're closely related. Just one more of the neat things that are in Lake Okeechobee in the region. Okay, what are these?
Air potatoes.
No, they're not air potatoes. Yeah, I heard it. What, Okeechobee gourd? Yeah, and so this is the Okeechobee gourd, and it's an endangered species. Actually, we think the Indians traded this because it's very, very similar to ones from Mexico. And the guys from the Desert Museum were out trying to get some genetic samples because these gourds, apparently the seeds are very nutritious, but the leaves are very resistant to a lot of things that, think about all the gourds and pumpkins and squash that we eat. And they're trying to get DNA out of this to find out how do these guys protect themselves from a lot of the crop pests we have. And if they can splice those genes into our crops, then they can protect them. So this is one of those biodiversity values from this kind of a otherwise homely little plant. Okay, I'm gonna talk about birds for a minute. We're the Audubon Society, and we're talking about birds. And so 5-6 years ago now, I was sitting in my office, and some guys from William and Mary sent me an email, and they said, can you tell us what this whimbrel's doing? And I'm like, what kind of habitat is this? And I'm like, here's these different marks. And I said, this is a whimbrel? And they're like, yeah. And I said, and they said, it just flew in. I said, from where? And they said, from Brazil. And I'm like, from Brazil? And they said, yeah, flew in last night. And it had been flying for 4 days. And so I said, well, these are just sugarcane fields. I don't know what it's doing down there. Anyway, they were very concerned because the whimbrels in Brazil usually fly from Brazil all the way to Chesapeake Bay in one flight. And this bird stopped in Florida. It got caught in a headwind. And so what they sent me was this map, and here it was. Here it was. They banded it up here in Chesapeake Bay. It flew all the way down to Brazil, spent the winter. It started coming north, and notice it zigzagged, and it couldn't keep making progress, and it came over and landed. And so they're like, uh-oh, what's going on with it? What they wanted to know is it still with the group? Because they fly in formation like geese, and they also want to know what kind of habitat it's in, because they're concerned about it. And so it just so happened the next day I was at a meeting and in West Palm Beach. And so when I was going back, I went to where all those stick pens were, and I was talking to one of our attorneys on the phone and going, you know, I'm looking for a whimbrel out here, but I'm just out in a sugarcane field. And so I hang up, and I look at the road, and there she is. And notice the pack on her back? That's actually the satellite radio. And so I call William and Mary, and I'm like, guys, I got your bird. You want me to put her on speakerphone? And then they're like, what kind of habitat is she in? And I'm like, she's walking down the side of the road. And she really literally was. And she was picking through the grass. And these guys are kind of upland feeders. I think she's looking for grasshoppers and stuff. And so anyway, as it turned out, she stayed in the EAA for 10 days. And she flew to Chesapeake Bay. And then she went on north. And she went up to the Hudson Bay region and did her breeding thing. She flew back down to Brazil the next year. And this is all on the internet, so I could follow her during her flights. And then she flew all the way back up the next year. But these guys, when they put the radios on them, they found that they do 110 to 160 hour flights. So that's flying for 6 days, thousands of miles in one flight. And you think about how can you even stay awake for 6 days? Birds can sleep with one part of their hemisphere. One half of their brain can sleep and the other half can be alert. We've seen that in mallards and flocks. The birds on the edge tend to have one eye open and one eye closed. And we assume these guys do that because who can go with them to really find that out? But anyway, just these astronomical feats of flight. And unfortunately, she left Virginia and she was headed back to Brazil. And this was on September 12th and she got caught in a tropical depression. And she went to the island of Guadalupe and she got shot by a hunter. Yeah. And there were four marked whimbrels, and two of them landed on Guadalupe that day, and both of them got shot. And unfortunately, it's a French protectorate. They don't have the same laws we do because we have the Migratory Bird Treaty Act with Canada and Mexico. They got under a lot of pressure because of that, and they actually have changed their hunting laws. They put a little bit more restrictions. The hunting club that she got shot on, the guy who shot her didn't know what was going on, and he turned the radio in. He said, you know, I got this bird. And I didn't, you know, mean to kill a bird. So anyway, that her death kind of raised a lot of awareness about these migratory birds. And whimbrel populations have declined a lot. You know, you shouldn't be hunting that bird. We hunt ducks and we hunt other things, but it's done under a very careful system, and this was not. So happily, some things have happened. And as it turns out, they went and put her radio out up here in the Mackenzie Delta, and they figured western birds would go down the west coast. Look what she did. Mackenzie, this new bird with Machi's old radio, flew all the way to Brazil. So anyway, these birds are just traveling the world. It's really incredible. And the Center for Conservation at William & Mary has more information on these birds. This is a red knot. You guys know about their migrations. They also fly thousands of miles. And they've done a lot of work on them. And when they are down in South America, what they do is they roughly double their body weight. They only weigh as much as, let's see, well, they weigh about as much as a soda can. And when they get ready to leave, they double their body weight and they get really, really fat. And about 2 or 3 days before they leave, they actually stop eating. And when they're getting fat, their gizzard gets bigger, their liver gets bigger, their kidneys get bigger, their heart gets bigger, because they have to process all that food. And before they fly, they stop eating and they reabsorb the materials from those organs, and they actually lose about 30% of their body weight. And so what they're left is they got a muscle and they got a big fat. That's their gas tank. And they take off flying, and they fly for day after day after day, and they burn that fat. And we can exercise and die with fat on us, but these guys can burn their fat while they fly. They also, if they run out of fat, they start burning their muscles. They can metabolize them that fast. And so it's just astonishing the things that they can do and the way they reconfigure their bodies. And it gets to the point that when we are hosting migratory birds, when they're here, they have to get fat. They have to, you know, especially in Florida, when they're jumping across the ocean, this is the last gas station. And if they don't get fat enough, making it 99% of the way doesn't get you there. So it's really important for us to have healthy habitats, not just to save our birds, but to save all birds in the continent. So what's this guy? Those are all swallowtail kites. And this is over in Fish Eating Creek. See the trees out here? See all the ornaments in them? Look at that. So this is another migratory bird that comes through Florida. This is in Fish Eating Creek. Fortunately, you can't get back there so nobody can bother them. It's a very remote area. But about half of all swallowtail kites in North America go to this one spot in Fish Eating Creek, Cowbone Marsh. And they're getting fat before they fly across the ocean. And so again, it's really important for us. You know, we're not just taking care of our birds or Everglades birds. We're taking care of North America's birds when we take care of Florida. And so here's some satellite tracking from Ken Meyer. And you notice, you know, here they are in Florida and they're getting ready to go. And they fly over to the Yucatan. And they actually go all the way down into South America. Okay, that's not me. Anyway, so we're part of a highway. These birds are coming and going. And so then there are some other guys. And they were putting radios on, or markers on bitterns up in Wisconsin. And they expected them to go to Louisiana. Look where most of them went. Here. They come to Florida for the winter. Again, you know, we are tied by these migratory birds. And all of these little lovelies were banded on Lake Okeechobee. And what do we call these birds? Yeah, warblers, well, some of them are vireos, neotropical migrants. These are guys that are coming and going. And so let's do the bird quiz. What's that?
Black pole,
prairie, Nashville, American Red Start, Prothonotary, Perula, Yellow Warbler, Yeah, pine warbler. Orange crown. Cape May. Goes on. Wide-eyed. Gnat catcher. Yeah, female painted bunting. A red-eyed vireo. Boy, you guys are good. Crested flycatcher. Yellow throat. Ground dove. Blue-eyed vireo. Or blue-headed vireo. There we go. Oops. There I go. I keep hitting this. Okay. Bobolink. Oh, come on. And swamp sparrow. Anyway, Tyler Beck from FWC took all these photos, and he was misnetting these guys on an island in Okeechobee. Actually, he had some birds that came back. They were caught in September on their way south, and the next September they came back to the exact same island. So when they're flying south, they're looking for places to go. If they have a good memory of a good spot where they got a lot of food and they were able to tank up and get across the ocean, they come back. Once again, you know, these guys are really important. Florida's really important for all kinds of birds. And this is Alyssa Jordan. She was helping. That's the before. This is the after. It's just funny. Cardinals can really bite hard. They can draw blood if they get you right. But anyway, so you think about North America and how big of an area up here, and we're just the neck of a funnel. And not all the birds go through Florida, but we are just, compared to other states, we are just so, so important. And I was at an Everglades Coalition conference, and Senator Graham saying, I have to convince senators from 49 states that they got to fund Everglades restoration. How do I tell them that it's important to them? And I'm a bird guy, and I'm like, well, duh, you know, your birds are coming through here, and if you want them to come back next year, you've got to take care of Florida. And it's not just because they're pretty and they sing well. These guys eat bugs. Here's a caterpillar. And so in Missouri, they put some tents over trees, and in the trees that had the tents that the birds couldn't get in, they started losing 25% of their leaves due to insect infestations. And the ones in the forest right next to them were only losing 13%. It significantly slowed down the growth of those trees. And so if you're a forester in Pennsylvania or in Nova Scotia, you care if these birds come back because it's your bottom line. If you're a gardener, it matters. And so this is one of those ecosystem services that scientists always say, and everybody goes, what are you talking about? But this is very real. So it's important, not only just from an aesthetic standpoint, but from a practical standpoint, we take care of these things. How do they ensure that they come back? You got to have good habitat. If they come to a spot and it's been bulldozed or whatever, they won't come back to that. So you just try to keep your habitat good, and the birds will, and then they start relying on you, and then it becomes even more important for you to keep up the good work. So why is this here? I'm talking about migration. Yeah, they migrate. There's actually a lot of everybody knows monarch butterflies migrate. Well, it turns out there's a lot of dragonflies that do, a lot of butterflies do. There's actually lots of things that migrate.
How do you know that? How can you put a radio on a dragonfly?
We're getting nanotechnology now, but they actually were putting little teeny tags on them, just like a band, a duck band, and just little paper things, and they'd stick them on there, and then they got enough recoveries to start. The big green and blue darners, I think they can live a couple years, and yeah, they'll go all the way from the Carolinas down here and go back up. It's pretty remarkable. And of course, these guys can eat on the wing, so migrating for them is not as much of a challenge as other things. But okay, so back to Okeechobee. All right, so in the good old days, we had this wonderful watershed. It was all smooth. The water would fill up in the summer, and it would very slowly drain into Okeechobee, and then it would very slowy go through the Everglades, and we had utopia and all that stuff. And this is down the road at the Myakka Cemetery. If you go down Canner Highway, there's a cemetery. And this marker says, to the 1,600 pioneers in this mass burial who gave their lives in the 1928 hurricane. And if you've ever read about that hurricane, it sent a wall of water over the town of Belglade. It killed probably 3,000 people. They don't know because it was so much chaos. Well, it was a 1928 hurricane, and they didn't have a name, but it killed close to 3,000 people. In 1926, another hurricane caused a storm surge out of Okeechobee, and it went over Moorhaven, killed probably 500 people. And so Florida has a history of dealing with hurricanes and actually perhaps overreacting to them. So this was one of the things that made us start trying to drain the state, trying to build the Hoover Dike around the lake to try to protect people from storm surges and from the water that can turn against us. And so in the 1940s, they had really wet hurricanes. And they took this pristine system and they said, you know, if we want to drain it, it's quicker to get the water here than it is all the way down there. And so they dug out the St. Lucie Canal. It was dug in the 19-teens, but they really made it big, so it was a major drainage feature. And so now when the water gets into Okeechobee, it goes east and west. And there used to be this big gush of water that went through the Everglades, and now it's very small. And the problem is, as you know, when the estuary gets too much water, it wrecks the estuary. When the lake gets too deep, it wrecks the lake. And then the Everglades, meanwhile, is parched, and they need water, and you don't need water. And so part of Everglades restoration is trying to rebuild the system so rather than dump the water, we can send it back to the Everglades. In a nutshell, that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to send it back where it's needed and stop dumping it where it's not needed. And so here's Florida. This is the CNSF system. Here's the Kissimmee River Canal and all these very efficient drainage systems. And actually, they designed a very good drainage system, and it really worked. And the general, one of the colonels that signed the study in 1949 said, Florida's got to remember you got two water problems. One's flooding, and we're building you a really good way to deal with floods, your drainage, but the other's droughts. And if you overdrain your state, you're going to make your droughts worse. And we're going to see in a minute that that's exactly what we did.
I have a question.
Yes?
Sounds open like Okeechobee. What is all that red stuff there?
Oh, the question is, what's this red stuff south of Okeechobee? This is the Everglades agricultural area. And so this used to be part of the Everglades, but it had really deep organic soils. They intentionally drained it, and that's where all the sugar farms are.
So is the soil red, or what makes it red?
This is an infrared photo, and it's warm. The sun's shining on it, and it's black soil, so it shows up bright red. But yeah, it shows up very well, doesn't it? So this is the Everglades agricultural area. And remember, the Everglades was a river of grass, and if you build a dam on a river, it has impacts. What if you put an entire agricultural place right in the middle of your river? Well, this is part of what we're trying to figure out how to get around, because while it's great to grow crops, it's also causing all kinds of problems. And so if you look at these habitats that we have in Florida now, whenever water falls on a farm field or in a city, what do we do with it? It doesn't sit there for 3 or 4 months and slowly go to the estuary. We put it right into a canal. It heads right downstream. And so every time it rains now, Okeechobee gets way more water than it used to. And so here's the, remember 2004, we had Charlie, Francis, Gene, and Ivan come across. Well, what happened to Okeechobee is it went from 12 feet, which is just fine. We don't want it to really pass that red line. It went from 12 feet to 18 feet in just 2 months. And as a matter of fact, within 1 month, they closed all the gates upstream of the lake because all the water was already in the lake. So we took essentially what would have taken 8 or 12 months to drain out the watershed. We put it all in the lake in 1 month. And that's really good because it keeps everybody upstream dry. But then the lake gets really deep. It caused a loss of 75 square miles of plants in the lake. Then we had massive estuary dumps. It killed your seagrasses. It killed your oysters, blah, blah, blah. And it's because all this water that fell in the landscape came rushing downstream onto the downstream systems. And so here's the lake 6 months later, and it's still dirty because it has a mud bottom from all the stuff that's washed into it. And you could hold your hand down 6 inches and you couldn't see it. So not only are you getting water out of the lake, but it's really bad water. And here's a spot. These are the same spots. And this was after the hurricanes, and all the plants were gone. And this is after a drought, and the stuff finally grew back. But Okeechobee lost, 75 square miles of plant communities. The fishery crashed, the birds all left. It was just a disaster. These little migrating warblers that are coming back to look for a good place, they got to Okeechobee. The bugs were gone. We used to have thousands of bugs per square meter in the bottom, and it dropped down to 2. So just complete wreck. The crappie fishery, I told you we catch 1 million. Look what happened. After 2005, it dropped to 0, and it stayed that way clear up until about 2014. It took about 10 years to recover that. So we don't want these things to happen very often. And here's the flip side of drought. Here's 2005, and here's Hurricane Wilma. The lake's up to 17 feet, and whatever didn't get drowned out last year got drowned out this year. But then here's the following spring, and here we are in May, March and May, and we're dumping water furiously to try to get the lake down to be ready for another hurricane season. It's killing your estuary, and everybody's really mad. And then we get into a drought. And here's the next year, and the lake goes all the way down to 9 feet, a record low. And when it drops below this dotted line, the farmers are getting rationed. And the sugarcane farmers during this period were only getting 50% of the water they needed. During the previous 2 years, we dumped enough water to meet all their water supply needs for 6 years. So it's a system that doesn't work for the environment when we get wet. It's a system that doesn't work for humans when we get dry. And it's because when we get water, instead of saving it and using it beneficially later, we dump it. And as soon as the drought starts, we're in trouble. And so that's the other part of Everglades restoration. We're going to try to catch this water somewhere where it doesn't wreck Lake Okeechobee. And then when the drought starts, we're going to have more water left for people and for the natural system. And this is part of the reason why everybody supports the Everglades restoration projects, because it's going to help farmers, it's going to help cities, it's going to help the natural environment. Now, we all fight about water every day because we have this water management system that doesn't work for us, but we got to remember we have a bigger goal. We all got to work together to rebuild this, to stop this bad pattern from happening. And that flashiness of the water system, where it goes really deep and really shallow, in the Everglades, we've lost about half the wetlands. We still have about half the Everglades left, but we only have 10% of the birds left. And it's because the remaining wetlands don't work right. They don't fluctuate properly because they go up too fast, go down too fast. And so you'd think we could at least have 50% of our birds left, but we don't. And that's part of what catching the water, keeping it out of the lake so it doesn't get too deep and starting that bad cascade of things happening. So, and you don't really need to understand these graphs, but here's your estuary. This is the desirable zone. There's where your water, your salinities are going. Here's the desirable zone. It's too salty, too fresh. And so, you know, if you're not in this zone very often, your grasses can't grow, they can't recover. And this is part of the problem with your estuary, is we need to be in these zones more reliably. And I talked about, this is a map of blue crab migrations from the Apalachicola, and they actually travel all the way down the Gulf of Mexico. And you think about your estuary, you guys are the spawning area for crabs, for shrimp, for oysters, for snappers, for groupers, for sharks, for turtles, for everything. I talked about the importance of Florida to migrating birds. What about migrating sea life? And think about your estuary. It is a breeding ground for all these things that they lay trillions of eggs, and the eggs go out into the ocean and they either get eaten or they become a predator and they become part of the food chain. And this little bitty estuary that's not shown right here really is important to this whole Atlantic area for fish. Once again, our spot is important to us, but it's important to everybody. And that's part of the reason why, you know, to Senator Graham, it's like, guys, we're all linked together. It's really important we take care of this. So not only we have water management problems, but as you guys know, we also have a lot of pollution. And the goal for Lake Okeechobee inside the lake is to have 40 parts per billion. And look at how we're doing. here's 2012. This was the hurricanes. It got really stirred up, and it settled out. Actually, it's gone back up now, but we need to get down to here, and we're not getting there, and it's because we have too much pollution flowing through our watersheds. And when you get too much phosphorus and nitrogen, they're fertilizers, and you know the simplest explanation is they make the water green, but what they do is you get algae blooms, and often it's the toxin-forming algae. They don't form at low nutrient levels. They form at high nutrient levels, and you get the mud bottom that stirred up the lake so bad, and it shades out plants, and cattails grow faster and the good stuff grows slower, and it's just, you don't want high nutrients in your, it makes your waterways into kind of a cesspool type thing. And so you guys are probably familiar with this. You know, this was a sign on the St. Lucie, high bacterial and blue-green algae, avoid contact with water in the St. Lucie River. I mean, if you're the Chamber of Commerce, do you want that sign at your boat ramp? I mean, ew. And this is on the other side. This is Lee County. This is the Caloosahatchee. Same thing. Stay out of the water. Don't touch it. This isn't what we want in Florida. So we got to get these nutrients out of the water and get back to having better stuff. And so here's your local watershed, and here's the C20 canals, and they all go right into the St. Lucie. So Okeechobee is a big problem, but like this summer, here's the amount of flow that went into the St. Lucie. And notice this big spike of fresh water coming out, and look what happened to your salinity. It went from the green, which is good, to the warning, to the bad. And none of this is Okeechobee water. The Okeechobee water is blue. This is all just from your own watershed. And so you guys have two problems. One is you have this watershed, which is drained and has pollution and impacts your estuary. Not only this, but this. And then you have Okeechobee. So you got to fix both of them. And if you just fix Okeechobee, you're still going to have this type of a problem and this type of a problem. And so here's this summer's releases. Once again, there's no flow from the lake, but you notice you got really big spikes. And that's why we need to build a reservoir to catch that water. Instead of dumping it in the estuary, we'll throw it in the reservoir. You won't have this big spike, and when the drought starts, we'll have water left over. And this is from 2013. Here is Okeechobee releases. And notice that most of your water, when Okeechobee gets cranking, comes from Okeechobee. So it doesn't happen every year, but when it happens, it's really bad. And this is what you get. People make fun of us. And it's, you know, kind of, it's funny. Okeechobee and the estuaries, but it's also, you know, it's sad. I mean, this is not a way to look at our ecosystems. We want them to be beautiful and have stuff. So what are we going to do about all this bad events? Okay, we have over drainage, so we need to build more storage. We have too much nutrients, so we have to start controlling them. And we also are diverting the water to the wrong spot. So you guys are getting water that should be going to the Everglades. So we got to fix all these problems. And I'm not going to really go through, if you work on this, there's SERP, there's SEP, there's the St. Lucie Protection Plan, the Basin Management Action Plans, BMPs for agriculture. But the bottom line is we need to build more storage capacity. That's the very first thing you do. When it rains, instead of throwing the water into our natural systems where it causes harm, let's build reservoirs, let's build holding areas, and put the water there. And once you do that, once you do that, Okeechobee doesn't get too deep and start that cascade of bad events. And then when the drought starts, we haven't lost all of our water, we still got it. And I know I say that all the time, but that's really, it's as simple as what we need to do. And so here in the C44, they're building this canal right now. I mean, this reservoir. And it's not going to help you from Okeechobee, but when it rains in this area, we can throw as much water as we can in here. It won't go down and make your estuary messed up. And this is the type of stuff that's going to help us cushion the estuary from big rain events. And then this water actually can be used by the farmers out here, and it never even has to go in the estuary with its nutrients and stuff. So this is the type of stuff we're trying to do, and they are building this right now. So in spite of a lot of complaints that the Everglades restoration isn't moving fast enough, there are things happening, and this reservoir is being built. And we need to move more water south out of Lake Okeechobee, quit dumping it on you. This is from Dr. Gary Goforth, and the red line is how many filter marshes. Have you guys seen those big STAs, the filter marshes they're building, and they run the water through it, and the plants take the nutrients out, and then by the time the water comes out, it's very clean, and you can put it in the Everglades, or you can put it somewhere. Well, this is how many acres of STAs they were building, and they got all the way up to, 56,000 acres, and here's how much water they were sending out of Okeechobee southward. And we're like, why are you building more and more acres, but you're not sending any water south? And Gary Goforth worked for the Water Management District, and he got this graph. And actually, the agencies got kind of embarrassed by this, because what they were doing is they were saving those STAs to treat the Everglades agricultural area water. Remember that red spot we looked at on the map? They're using it all, but they weren't up to capacity. They were leaving them empty and leaving them dry, and they weren't even using them because they were waiting for sugarcane runoff. And so what we got them to do is they start moving Okeechobee water, and now they're actually... A couple years ago, they moved an entire foot of Okeechobee water south to the Everglades through these STAs rather than dumping it on the estuaries. And that's just with stuff we've already built. So there are improvements happening right now. We're starting to manage the system better. And you may not notice it, but that's 1 foot of water. That's a few months of really harmful dumps to your estuary that got sent south, and it benefited the Everglades. So we're making progress. It's incremental, but it's happening. Okay, and so what's this bird? Scissortail flycatcher. And when the Everglades Restoration Plan, SERP, was voted in Congress, there was only one senator who voted against it, and it was Senator Imhoff from Oklahoma. What's this bird have to do with Oklahoma? State bird. This is the state bird of Okeechobee, of Oklahoma. And I felt like sending him the picture and saying, Senator, if you want your bird back, restore the Everglades. But I never did. Anyway, so here's the Kissimmee River Canal. This is the big mistake we made. You know, you can see the old meander. And... this picture was taken 1 year ago. And so, let's see. The canal used to be right here. And you notice it's meandering. The whole floodplain's full. And so instead of water rushing to Lake Okeechobee in a big hurry, here it's going very slowly. It's filled up all this area. It's habitat. The water's getting cleaned by the plants. So when it comes out of there, it's going to be nicer. And so this is a project, one of the projects we have going on, that's really going to help us improve our watershed. And if you build it, the birds will come back. This is on the Kissimmee River. So and the best thing is this is 4 miles from my house. So, but anyway, so we are making some progress. And these are the types of things. We've got to do this all over Florida. We've got to rebuild our watershed so we have much more of this and much less drained stuff. And so here's the old citrus pattern. And any drop of water that lands out here quickly gets to an estuary near you. Here's the way we're trying to build them now. And this is one of the Likes Brothers grows, and so we're still having intense agriculture, we're still growing a lot of food for people, but instead of blowing out this wetland, you know, when I talked to them too, they said they can drain that, but it's still a low spot, and when it rains, the water stays in there long enough that the trees just don't grow very well. And so for the citrus guys, they just said it's not worth our trouble to do that, so, you know, this helps us, and it helps protect our watersheds and keep them intact, but we still have agriculture and human activities. And this is a cattle ranch. If you go to the Okeechobee watershed, most of it's in cattle. People don't realize we're one of the biggest cattle states in the country. And if you've been to Bud Adams Ranch, you've probably heard this story. But those wetlands have a lot of ranch wetlands have a lot of biological value. And so one of the things we're trying to do is, instead of waiting to build a huge reservoir, we're starting to pay ranchers, will you just plug your ditches when it rains, instead of all your water running downstream, let us stay there for another couple months? And so we've got programs like that where we're trying to convince, and it's under different names. They call it the Florida Ranchlands Environmental Services Project. This was the original experiment to see if we could do that and if it would work. But now we have water farming. You guys may have heard about that, where they're paying some of the citrus growers to hold water on their property. And we have a payment for environmental services where we're paying ranchers to hold water. This also is in your watershed. This is the Allapata Flats restoration area. And so here it was all drained, and they went in and plugged the ditches, and here it is all flooded. And so now when it rains on this tract of land, instead of all this water getting into the estuary, it stays out there, it makes habitat, it's good for the birds. When farmers do this, they can still run cows out there during the dry season, and what they found is it doesn't really actually hurt your production. The wetlands are very productive, and so you take your cows out during the wet period and you put them back in during the dry period, and really you can still farm, and we can still have these services. So this is a project that's working for you right now. This is a wetland reserve program. We bought conservation easements from these guys. This pond right here is completely drained right now. It's about 3 miles across. It's the headwaters of Fish Eating Creek, and they're going to reflood it now. We bought easements from these guys. They're going to keep farming it. It's going to stay on the tax rolls. It's going to keep producing food and fiber, but now it's going to start holding water and making our watershed wet again. So these are projects that we work on as much as we can. And this is just a little wetland out in the field. And remember I was talking about birds getting fat and stuff, and people don't value little wetlands like this. And this will last for a couple weeks, and birds can get in here and get enough fuel on them to fly all the way to Michigan. These are really important habitats, and we have not valued wetlands. We have not valued our resources. And so even little things like this can be tremendously important, not only to water. You know, instead of draining this in one day, can you at least hold the water for 3 weeks? And they're very important for birds, too. So this is something that we're getting a better appreciation of for people to learn. And here's the Kissimmee Valley. Here's Lake Okeechobee. There's a town of Okeechobee. There's Belglade. That's probably Pahokee, Clewiston. But notice how dark it is up here? It's a huge area. So it's our watershed. And we have a lot of places where we can store water, and we can re-wet that watershed and try to make our headwaters, instead of being a big threat to us, where every time it rains, they dump everything on us immediately, we can try to work with them to hold the water up there. And the longer they can hold it, the better our watersheds are going to work. And not to complain too much, but basically, what do we want? We want a wet Florida. What did we used to have? and now we're going to have to pay for it, because we didn't value wetlands enough, we didn't value our waterways and our rivers enough, and we drained them, and now we're trying to pay money to restore them. Well, okay, that's all water under the bridge, but what we're trying to do is get back something that we weren't smart enough about protecting. And it goes back to what that colonel said when the first plan was written. If you overuse your drainage, you're gonna make your droughts worse, and we did that, and now we're trying to fix that mistake. So here's what we want. We want a lake you can fish in that's not been wrecked and lost all its plants. We want wading bird rookeries that the hydrology is good enough, wading birds can nest. You know, that 50% loss of wetlands and 90% loss of birds, we need to get our birds back. And we want a Florida that little neotropical migrants can come and enjoy and move north and south as they need to. Okay, thank you.